everyone.
Well, come on, good morning.
Good morning.
There we go. No push-ups are required, okay? Or take it easy. By way of some introductions, I would like to introduce the some members of professional staff of the House Veterans Affairs Committee who are also with us here today. You'll stand Mike Brink, who was with us about a month ago, and Dolores Dunn, and John Clark, three. So these are very good sources, and you really don't have to do that, John. Thank you. Also, from personal staff, Mike Cooper. Is Mike, did he have to step out? Mike in the back is my chief of staff, and Jim Houston is also here. From Dan Burton's staff. Anyone else?
Steve Powell, College and Sowers.
Oh, awesome. Thank you very much for coming out. Many of you attended our post 9/11 GI forum last month, and you'll remember at the end of the session at Q&A, we began discussing how veterans, especially those who have combat experience, transition from wearing camis to campus. It was clear to me that some of the schools are less than comfortable with the issues that our veterans may bring with them, and it is understandable. And last year's reauthorization of the Higher Education Act included several positions to assist veterans. First, it authorized a grant program administered by the United States Department of Education called the Centers of Excellence for Veteran Student Success. And this was done to provide a single point of contact to coordinate comprehensive support services for veteran students. The grants would require a full range of support services from admissions through disability services. And that's one of the issues that hopefully we can discuss today, are disability services. It's an issue that we end up spending a lot of time with on the Veterans Affairs Committee in our work with the VA and adaptive housing issues. For example, one of the best campuses here in Indiana with regard to the blind is Ball State University. And, we need to get the word out with regard to what campuses are the best with regard to adaptive housing, how we can also assist our disabled veterans, given particular forms of disabilities that they may have. I provide a copy of the provisions that are referred to in your package. Unfortunately, the House Appropriations Committee has only funded the program at $8 million for the next fiscal year. And I had hoped to include it, to increase it to $22 million, but the amendment was not permitted on a technicality. It was my hope that the $8 million will set a good foundation, though, for kinds of services we'll discuss today, and hopefully we'll build a foundation so I can proceed also forward with regard to funding for next year. And I've been looking forward to our discussions after we have our presenters. Let's use mental health services as an example, and I suspect that at least our larger institutions have social service and mental health degree programs. Perhaps appropriately credentialed faculty and even graduate students could gain some real-world experience assisting with issues in these areas. Also, perhaps schools located in the same area, like those around Indianapolis, could pool internal resources to form their own centers of excellence. There are a lot of ways to affect these types of changes, and we're going to learn some of these today. Our agenda here includes senior officials in charge of the VA's Vocational Rehabilitation Employment Program, representatives from the VA Medical Center here in Indianapolis to discuss VA resources available to your students. We'll also hear from representatives from Purdue University's Military Family Research Institute about a grant program that they offer to assist Indiana colleges and universities to pay for transitioning services. We'll also hear from representatives of a relatively new organization called the Student Veterans of America to discuss the types of challenges some of our today's veterans are facing in making transition. And finally, you're the featured speaker. So after we have our presentations here this morning, then I want to get into a round-robin discussion on how best we can tackle these issues, since our goals here are to move toward solutions for a full spectrum of resources and initiatives to help our veterans. One thing I do know, and I'll do this by way of opening, is maybe they come from an ROTC program, maybe they're senior NCOs or senior officers. There might even be a graduate student or someone whom is a veteran. And the creation of these mentorship programs will be extremely important. We can always refer them to social service, or if an individual has a suicide ideation, experts know how to handle those types of things. But I can tell you that a veteran is extremely comfortable talking to someone who has just had the very similar experience that they've had and how they can transition. So the development of those types of programs is extremely important, and something that hopefully we can also discuss here today. We're going to go, we're going to follow the agenda here, and we'll keep ourselves on pace. We'll open with John Myers with the VA Regional Vocational Rehabilitation. John, I recognize.
Give me just a second here. Can you all hear me? Good. Save me the trouble of being. First of all, I want to thank Congressman Weir and his staff. Opportunity. I think it's an extremely important reason that we have, and I can tell you that.